So far, we have considered transformations that are entirely in 3D. So they deal with how do you take an object in the 3D world and place it somewhere else in the 3D world. In this lecture, we're going to talk about viewing, because ultimately we look at computer graphics images that are two-dimensional, and therefore we have to take this 3D world and project it into a 2D image. While we're talking about computer graphics, we're of course inspired by similar processes that occur in the human eye and in real cameras. We have seen transforms so far between coordinate systems, but of course all of that is 3D. How do you go from 3D to 2D, and how do you project the three-dimensional space to the two-dimensional space is the fascinating topic that this lecture is about. I'm going to start off by showing you a demo with this projection tutorial. These come from Nate Robbins' OpenGL tutors, and if you just search on the web for that, you will see many interesting tutorials that give you a good understanding of several aspects of 3D computer graphics and also how to implement them in OpenGL. So here we have our projection tutorial. And so what it shows is the world space view on the left and the actual image that you see on the right. So what I can do here is that I can increase the field of view. And as I increase the field of view, you see that the man becomes smaller. As I decrease the field of view, he becomes larger. And that's because I'm looking at a smaller region. So that is one parameter of my viewing transformation. I can also change the aspect ratio, which affects the width to height. And finally, I have the Z near and Z far, which are the near and far clipping planes. They don't really do anything until I pass them through the object, and then you lose some of the object. In this lecture, we are going to understand all of these concepts and derive the matrices that are actually used in OpenGL. To summarize what we've seen so far, we've seen transformations, translation, rotation, scale, and how to put them together. All of this is done using 4n×4 homogeneous matrices, and so far they were motivated primarily by the ability to capture translation. However, 4x4 matrices are also useful to capture viewing, and indeed there is a unified way to write the entire transformation pipeline. The last row in these matrices is always been so far 0, 0, 0, 1, just keeping the W coordinate unchanged. For viewing transformations, we will play with this last row as well as other parts of the matrix. This segment deals with orthographic projection, which is the simplest one, and then we'll deal with perspective projection, which is the most common way in which images are created. First, consider the problem formally. You have a three-dimensional space and you want to project it down to two dimensions. That's essentially the meaning of projection. One obvious way of doing that would be to take your three coordinates in the three-dimensional space and drop one of them to a two-dimensional space. Indeed, orthographic projection at a high level is just taking x, y, z of your 3D space and dropping the z-coordinate, so you get x, y on the screen. It preserves straight lines, which is one of the main advantages of it, and it looks something like this. So one of the characteristics of orthographic transformation is that parallel lines remain parallel. Some of you may have remembered if you see images of, for example, railroad tracks, those are clearly parallel lines, but in a standard camera image, they will seem to be getting closer together till they meet in the far distance. You, of course, never see them meet. They meet only at infinity, but they get closer to each other. That's because the image was created using perspective projection. With orthographic projection, the parallel lines remain parallel, and this is useful for many technical drawings to convey the view of the object. And you may, for example, take an orthographic view along each of the x, y, and z axes. So here I've drawn an example of a cube, and you see with the perspective transformation, parallel lines are no longer parallel, the cube is somewhat distorted, whereas in the orthographic case, we maintain those parallel lines. What we're going to talk about now is the general form of the orthographic transformation. It's something known as GL ortho, and we'll just go over it as a warm-up to derive the formula for GLU perspective for perspective transformations. The basic idea for the general orthographic transformation is that you have a cuboid in world space. So here is your cuboid. You want to map that cuboid first to the center it, and then finally map it down to the unit cube. And indeed, all of the transformations we'll see, GLU ortho, GLU perspective, essentially compute a mapping of some region of the world down to the unit cube. Of course, you can argue that this mapping is still in three dimensions, so what's going on? But the idea is that once we mapped it to the unit cube, then we can just drop the z-coordinate and look at the xy coordinates. So how do we go about it? The first thing is that we need to define the axes of the cube. And so since it's a cuboid, which is parallel to the x, y, and z, the left and right components are just L and R, and that corresponds to these faces. So this face here, that's the left and right. The near and far are where you lie along the z-axis. So the near plane is how the closest location, and the far plane is the furthest location. And then we have top and bottom. So top and bottom. So I'm just reprising the different steps that you're going to take, where you first center the cuboid and then you scale it into the unit cube. And for each of these steps, we can derive the appropriate matrices. And the idea is as follows. I have my cuboid. I'm going to draw it here. And so firstly, these are L and R. L and R. And this must go to something that is centered. And so we want it to have the same length, but now this point must move to the center. And of course, the translation that will make that happen is to consider the central location here, which must be equal to L plus R divided by 2. And therefore, the translation will be the negative of this in order to bring this to the center. Similarly, for top and bottom, you will have minus top plus bottom over 2. And that will be the case for the near and far planes as well. I'm not going to write that down, but that would be minus far plus near over 2. The next question is, what happens to the scale? And of course, the scale will depend on the inverse of this length. So this is the translation. And now let's look at the scale. In this case, you will look at this total extent and will want to scale that into the unit cube. In this case, the unit cube goes from minus 1 to plus 1. So this total extent will go from minus 1 to plus 1, which is a total of 2 units. So of course, the scale will be 2 units divided by the original length. So this will be equal to 2 divided by R minus L. 2 divided by R minus L, and similarly 2 divided by T minus B, and 2 divided by far minus near. So let's look at what this looks like. The scale matrix is 2 divided by R minus L, 2 divided by T minus B, 2 divided by F minus N. Notice that the scale comes second. The first step is the translation. And the translation is left plus right divided by 2 with a minus sign, top plus bottom divided by 2, far plus near divided by 2. And so far I've left the homogeneous coordinate row the same. One can multiply this out and it's easy to see what happens. It's similar in many ways to what we did if you do translation first and then rotation. So the upper left 3 by 3 remains from the scale and you can see that quite clearly. But for the translation, you have to multiply the scale by the translation. And so 2 and 2 cross out, but you'll get minus L plus R over R minus L. And that can be written as L plus R over L minus R. As an exercise, you might want to multiply this out together yourself. There is one final change that needs to be done to get the GL ortho formula, which is that that in OpenGL, the convention is that you're looking down the minus C axis. Therefore, N and F are both negative numbers. So N is closer than F, and it's a smaller negative number than F. However, when you specify the arguments, you specify N and F as positive values. And therefore, in the formulae, you have to replace N by minus N and F by minus F, which all it does is it changes one sign to negative. And in particular, the formulae for M is, again, the upper left 3 by 3 doesn't change. It's 2 by R minus L, T minus B, F minus N, And here, R plus L, R minus L, top plus bottom, top minus bottom, and so on. But there is one sign change that happens when you replace far and near by their negative values, which is that this sign changes. And that's the final formula for GL ortho. Why have I introduced the derivation of these formulae, GL you look at in the previous lecture and GL ortho in this lecture? Because eventually, when you actually design a scene using OpenGL, what it does is it takes all of the geometric points and it transforms them by a 4x4 matrix. Of course, you can, if you're writing in OpenGL, just specify GL ortho with some intuitive parameters. But of course, the goal of this course is to understand how the 3D pipeline works, and therefore you need to understand the basics of orthographic and perspective projections and how one creates 4x4 matrices that one actually uses from them.